The Lime Pit, a Harry Stoner mystery by Jonathan Valin, narrated by Mark Peckham. Chapter 1. It was a warm noon in early July. From my desk, I watched a black-bodied wasp floating past the screen of the office window. He and a dozen or so of his cronies had built a hive on the sixth-floor corners of the Ryerly building, directly below my office. And now, in the early summer heat, they circled and droned through the air in a lazy, rancorous cloud, like a little spot of bad weather in an otherwise flawless sky. I had just gotten back to Cincinnati Thursday morning after spending the better part of 2 days in Chicago running down a con man by the name of Aaron Mull. He was an interesting character. Mull? A kind of Corn Belt Prospero who had tricked two realtors into parting with a large sum of cash. It was a beautiful scam, and it could only have been run on the very greedy or the maladroit, which was why the two real estate men had looked so goddamn angry when they popped into my office on the first of the month. The taller and more imposing of the pair, a bug-eyed man named Leo Meyer, explained the situation in a hoarse, aggrieved voice, while his partner Larry Cox literally wrung his hands in rage. They were not so newly rich men, used to getting their own ways in a world of cutthroat scheming. They had worked their way up, so Meyer told me, the hard way, had fought for every penny that was theirs. And, so I told myself, though I didn't tell Meyer, it had taken this schemer, Aaron Mull, to summon up a history that had been, for a decade at least, buried under the loosed earth of acquisitions. Fine houses, fine cars, and fine clothes. The tailored suits, that Brooks Brothers shirts and ties, the bally shoes, that now seemed to Meyer mere figments from some other dream of worldly happiness. I took the case. Hell, why not? Meyer's self-righteousness may have been as phony as Mull's scam, and his usual business ethics just as questionable. But money is money, whoever has handled it. And once in your hands, it's an orphan, a new limb waiting to be grafted green on the family tree. I'd found Mull all right, working the same scam on a Northside Chicago realtor, and I turned him over to the police. Not without a tussle, however. Because Aaron Mull was a crafty son of a bitch, and like most imaginative men, a selfish one. In fact, when I finally caught up with him in the tar lot of a Northside IGA, he denied he was Aaron Mull. And, just for a second, in the dry, shimmering heat of that grocery parking lot, I believed him. Maybe it was the heat, or maybe it was just another facet of that gift that made him so good at what he did. But by God, in his checkered short-sleeved shirt, his Levi's and hush puppies, with a shock of pale brown hair, his tan, beardless face and huckleberry grin, he didn't look like an Aaron Mull. He backed away, smiling with just the right air of affronted good nature. And then I collared him. Mull jerked away, and there followed a merry chase among the parked cars and abandoned grocery carts. I had to bash him one at the end of it, a hard tap across the noggin with my pistol, which really wasn't fair, as Mull pointed out when I cuffed him and called the police. It was about midnight when the Chicago cops finished with me. The night was blessedly cool after the heat of the day, and rather than waiting for it to warm up again and driving in a sweat all the way back to Cincy, I walked over to the police lot, got in my Pinto, and headed out lakeshore to Stony Island, and from there to the Indiana toll road and the interstate that led to home. I stopped once at a Stuckey's outside of Indianapolis for a cup of coffee and an egg salad sandwich. And while the waitress sauntered sleepy-eyed behind the counter and a handful of truckers, dressed in jeans and work shirts with open-backed cat for caterpillar caps on their heads, chatted and joked in one of the booths, I nursed my cup of coffee and watched the sunrise through the truck stop window. I felt good. I'd done a good job. And, with the money I'd made from it, I could just keep driving on 65, all the way down through Kentucky, Tennessee, and Mississippi to the Gulf. It was a wonderful feeling of freedom that didn't last much longer than the moment it took me to reflect on how hot it would be on the Gulf, and how little I liked driving through the swelter of July. But it was a feeling that very few people can afford to indulge in. Maybe the truckers at the nearby booth, and maybe the two real estate tycoons whom I would call from my office that morning. You have to be god-awful rich, or one of the chosen poor, to entertain the illusion that your life is a matter of free choices. It's mostly an illusion, as Mullet found out, but it's a damn good feeling while it lasts. Almost worth a year or two in the slammer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.